So thanks for coming, everyone, for today's artist talk for the current show. Unfortunately, Erin Castellan can't be here. She lives in North Carolina, I couldn't make it. But we have Keith Leitner and Ruslan Khais here to talk about their work in the show. So let's give these two guys a warm welcome.
Well, one, it's a beautiful show because of the colors involved. I mean, it's hard not to be dazzled. All three artists I've seen post your paintings, the sense of touch in your work, I really enjoy it.
Yeah, well, I like the touch.
And the vibrant color that you use. And contrast that with, you know, Erin's. You know, she has tapestry, printmaking, monotype, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So again, the touch. And then my work basically is realized on color almost singularly. And then their work's on paper, so I try and get some texture into these, but I don't have a lot. My low paintings usually have a lot more texture than this. But I like the works on paper. I can knock these out relatively quickly, whereas with my oil paintings, they take a long time because I let things dry. I'll put layers down, let them dry before I go on, because I like to be able to dry back into things. It's a little difficult with works on paper, but I'm fairly pleased with how these turned out. And your turn.
Okay. Picking up where Keith left, I think what I do, if speak a little bit about also, in my view, what I see, it's a beautiful expose on the sensitivity of the paint and sensitivity of the texture. There is beautiful Mike, beautiful Keith work with a very thin and very mid, and very, very cosmic light application, which when you look at this, it's almost not done like a human being. It in my sense, it's almost like you can see the talking to like it's like very cosmos-like pieces. There is almost things which is happened by the elements, not by the human hand. And I consider myself to be very physical with the palette knife, and there is a lot of the pure pleasure of what you take just about just pushing the amount of pain with the palette knife of physical application. And talking about the texture, the different, this have a totally different feeling, you know, in some way, talking about less about painting application, another way, it's taking it toward completely different direction when it's getting to the small sculpture relief. So I think it's all together, it's very, very sensitive show which came up together. Because as far as we are different, there is a lot of similarity on the core level. And it's just, I'm probably the more representational artist from this group. Representational, which I really did not thought what I will be, but it just happened. There is a few smaller work. I usually start from the particular point of it's not a process. It's just a transformation or distillation of the particular image in the nature in the maybe slightly naive, maybe slightly romantic. Usually it's getting, lately it's getting very pastoral. It's like, oh, this is light coming from the tree. Oh, a few clouds over face of the grass in Lancaster County. But then you come to the studio, you man up and you pick up a 3-inch palette knife and you're just putting something like 2 inches thick and it kind of feels good and feels right. I don't know what else to say, just like thank you for Mike and Tina great opportunity, beautiful show. My works looks twice better here as they are in the studio. And this is pretty much it. I don't know, any questions or anything?
What do you call this one?
This one called Mighty Spring. It's basically, it's a little bit, it's supposed to be a sycamore alley.
Sycamore alley
in Jenkintown. Okay. And I did stop the dip when I started to do it. I was called by local people with, I have a police cruiser stand by. Because they saw the strange guy in the neighborhood doing something. He was doing something! And cop came and he looked at me and he checked my driver license and he approved the way the painting was going. And the only thing, it's sycamore tree is my favorite tree.
Okay.
Because when the bark started to peel off and sunlight hitted it and it's over the blue sky, it gives you the most amazing array of the colors.
Okay.
From the pale yellow to the deep violet. So the only where I have to cheat on this painting was, it started as a fall painting.
Okay.
But as long as it was developed, the colors, you only control painting for, I would say, 80%.
Okay.
20%, you have to be ready to change it. But sometimes painting takes its course and you have to make an excusative decision. Will I follow with the things which happenings unexpectedly happening on the canvas, or I'm gonna rape it and enforce it in my own way. This one I decided to let it go as it was, and the palette become to be a little bit more pastel, on pastel level. So instead of sycamore tree in mid-October, it's become to be my display. It's not to be my display.
And Keith, these are yours here. That are framed. Yours are all framed, right?
Yeah, with the exception of two of your Erin's.
Okay.
No. So what do you
call these two?
They're all untitled.
They're untitled?
Yeah, I don't use titles.
Okay.
Rarely. Sometimes I do. Titles tend to... titles are very hard for me to do because they tend to lead people a certain way. I don't want to do anything.
Okay.
I don't want to lead people on. I think it's very confusing in shows when everything's untitled, so I put a catalog number with them.
So you let the people who buy them
they
put a title
to
them?
If they want to, they could.
Okay.
But yeah, basically all my work has been untitled.
Do you sign all of your?
On the back, yeah.
On the back?
Yeah.
Okay.
But what you said about the cosmic, or I don't have to show my hand in my work. I mean, it's there, but I try not to show it.
No, but this is one of the valuable. It's there is like a few school of thoughts. For sometimes you have to master material, you know, to make it. Some people like to. I am very brutal nature. I like to simplify it as much as possible. But there is another school of thought where you have to. Well, you don't show it your hand. So this is just it's an artistic weapon to admire as I look from. It's been so much now, but this is just a real matter of weapon of choice.
So how long does it take you to do a painting like this?
Sometimes when you get lucky, you can do real. Usually a few months.
Okay, and Keith.
Well, I'm a lazy painter. So I'll put something down, like I said, and let it dry, and go back into it. It depends.
So how long do you let it go in between?
Good question. It depends on how much I want to go away, and
okay.
How much I want to hold on to.
Okay.
There's a lot of me tearing back through it.
Uh-huh. When you go back to it, do you ever change it? Change like when you're starting out. Do you change your whole idea?
I never know what it's going to look like
until
the very end.
Okay.
Until it is off the boil,
okay.
When it quits annoying me, then
okay.
I'm done with it.
Okay. So with you, how long, like when you start out, do you know what your end result's going to be?
I have an ideas.
Okay.
But again, I try to be very flexible in order to, sometimes during the process, I don't have to tell what painting will tell you.
Okay.
But there is certain things sometimes happening on the canvas which suggest a slightly different direction. And you have to be very careful not to kill it, because sometimes as an artist you have like a horse which drives buggy. You have a shorts on your eye. You just see where you want to go.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it's, and I think it's important if you take it off the shoulder when you see what else is happening.
Do you, you know, change a lot?
Yes, I do. Yes,
okay.
I do. Yes, I do. Sometimes I can push it totally in a totally different direction. If it's I usually start on the same motif, I usually start two or three canvases.
Oh, okay.
And usually then I'm like a Greek tragedy. I'm gonna, this one you're gonna live and this one you're gonna die. unless dramatic changes change nothing.
So you're both do great work, beautiful colors, but your mindsets are totally opposite.
You would talk about going out in the field and people looking at you funny. For something like this, when you go out in the field, are you sketching or are you actually bringing the canvas?
I usually prefer to bring the canvas, and this is why I'm doomed to drive minivans for the rest of my life.
But so, if it's taking a series of months, are you going out to the same site, or do you go out there and sort of capture that one moment?
I go to capture this particular moment, and once I've satisfied what I got, then this could be work in the studio. I do the photographs and the references. It's taken a long time to find this particular, you know, it's almost like something have to click on celestial level when you are exactly at this point, and the architecture of the trees works, and the light is coming in some kind of interesting way. But there is something unusual happening, and you have this kind of, you know, not a butterfly in my stomach. I could have a cloud of flamingos, but you know, but there is something. You feel it. You know, you just like click. I said, oh, this is great. This is great. This is what I know. And when you push it there, you come from the same space, just to the same spot, you come 3 hours later, 15 minutes earlier. And sometimes it's really a measure of, I'm not an atmospheric painter like a Turner, but there is a lot of, it's, you know, in order to find this particular point of departure, it sometimes it does matter of 10, 15 minutes. Because the light sound goes up, light it changes and it's gone. Mm-hmm. And you drive again by this point and it's nothing there.
Since that moment that you're capturing,
yep, it's very difficult to find.
And then you're in the studio, does that sort of, you're talking about how they
keep you're gone, but then you can go again in similar circumstances and look and refresh yourself. You have photographs for the references and then you're gonna know.
Because I was wondering if you're trying to hold on to that moment and sort of remember it, but you are trying to hold on to it enough,
yeah,
that you will go back and try to refresh that.
Absolutely, absolutely. If I manage, but sometimes, for example, in the spring, there is a certain light coming from this amount of leaves, and then there is more leaves, and you know, in more leaves, and it's changing.
Right.
Or in the autumn, the wind is blowing, half of the leaf gone, totally different thing. So it's kind of balancing act.
Well, then you, Keith, you're outside. You do a lot of nature. You did at one point.
I did a lot of plein air painting, my paintings and these works.
Where did you do these?
These were in the studio,
okay.
I tend not to just walk around and observe things.
Yeah, you
and
like
let,
that.
And let them
right.
soak in.
Okay.
And let things come out. I look at a lot of walls and sidewalks, so I'm still looking kind of like the cityscape or the landscape. But I'm trying to see what I digest.
Okay.
I'm looking at texture and edges. I love SEPTA because they're always painting things over badly. So there's gorgeous edges. I love edges. and I walk through underground septa, and I'm always seeing things that would be. And I don't want to paint them verbatim. I don't want to say, okay, this I'm going to replicate this subway wall. I just try to find textures and edges and impressions that I can use.
Okay.
I'm pretty much the.
So how long have you been doing this type of painting?
About 2 years worth. There's one, there's a red painting back there that might be
Yeah.
That actually, this all started with that. That's about 2 years old.
Okay.
You
call these abstract? Is that what you
know? Yeah, no, they're it's all abstract.
Okay.
It's all abstract.
Okay.
And I'm very fond of painters who work this way. Warren Rohr was a fellow painter I'm very much in love with to this day. He used beetle paints. Agnes Martin, who's minimalist, and there was a gorgeous show of hers at Guggenheim in the winter that I'm very happy I got to see.
And where was that?
At the Guggenheim in New York.
Uh-huh.
And just beautiful minimalist paintings that rely on touch and color. I'm kind of in a good place right now.
Good.
I get stuff out, and I'm very. When I work with this, I'm very happy when I work.
Mm-hmm.
I forget a lot of things that I don't want to remember, and I close the world out and just get involved with these things.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very lazy. I put me down and let it happen.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You had talked about how when you start, you have no idea of what it's going
mm-hmm.
to be. Is there a certain amount of unconscious?
Yeah, I don't. The way I work, you said you work on a couple canvases at a time.
Mm-hmm.
I'll put down a couple sheets of paper, and you know, after a while, they'll start to talk to each other. They'll be talking about something, I don't know what. Maybe it's a range of colors, maybe it's a combination of medium, I don't know. But as a starting point, I teach a painting class, and the thing that is the hardest thing for my students is, where do I start? I mean, just put something down, it doesn't matter. Most of these just start with me putting down a wash or something, and I let it bother me for a little bit, and I go back into it.
So you just sort of you come up with a color, and then that becomes...
Very often, I'm just like, turn around and grab something.
And that's where the first step, just
that's
to
the
get
step.
Away from
and that can go away completely. I mean, the first step in
mm-hmm.
a lot of these paintings is way
okay.
gone.
Right, I mean, a lot of your work is about layering things, so that's...
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah, Paul asked me about what was in this painting over here, and I like to build layers up. And go back down through.
We would also mention trying not to show your hand.
Yeah.
Is that specifically in works on paper? Because in your paintings with the carving?
Yeah. Well, my hand's still there, but I'm not.
It doesn't look like.
Yeah.
It's
yeah,
more
right.
like
a lot of my oil paintings, you have a lot of carving into them and stuff.
Do you hide things in your painting? Like hide?
No.
Okay.
No. No, I mean, I'm not hiding.
If you put them on the turning table and start to twist them, is there anything hidden?
No.
Well, you know, some people do when they're painting.
Yeah.
They
it's just what it is.
Did these kind of like come together? Did they group or they were totally done?
These four, those two, and these two are they're within a few months.
Tell me, but those two are different from others. Focus is rather...
Is that a brick wall?
No, not a brick wall. These are actually the last two that I did.
Mm-hmm.
This rhythm, this line, whatever it is, it keeps showing up now.
Yeah, focus is not to the edge now.
It
looks like the inside.
Yeah, no, that's a good observation. Yeah, I'm not quite sure where this stuff's coming from.
Mm-hmm.
I really don't, but I have more paper at home
with this
happening now, and I'm not quite sure what it is. And that's cool, I'm good with that. There was a long time why I was not comfortable working this way. I'm very much a Ruslan, I'm with you. This is where I started. And it was hard for me to let...
Texture go.
Representation,
You know, it's very interesting because we are as an artist, we cannot predict, how people want to react. On the work. I mean, and I see, well, for example, when I see something like this, you know, this is more talking about, it's, for me, it's something very I don't know, terraforming on galactical level, that is, it's inside of the volcano or the planet get burned, you know, and this is just the same thing, with just slightly attempt to structurize.
Yeah.
All this cosmic elements trying to, just trying to structurize them on a certain level with the rhythm.
I think this
is how I read it. Yeah, but it's all started from looking on the set, badly painted set at the wall. You know, just like again, it's a lot of the origins are extremely different, but in the end, we're all dealing with a similar issue. The sensitivity, the harmony, the clarity. I mean, the certain kind of music of the crystal spheres, which you do not trying to hear, trying to represent. Except, you know, you can start from the point just to put something, like in that, or I try to withhold myself until you so filled with the emotion or with some ideas, you are ready to pop like a bottle of champagne. Only then bring up the canvas. You know, only then when you started to put up, you started to work on the canvas at the moment of the peak of concentration of the emotions which you have inside with the ideas. Because for me, when you, I mean, this is one way, and kids have totally different way, and in the end, its results are in a certain way very similar. Very similar.
Just from curiosity, Bill is here, so were you the student of Bill, or Bill was your...
No. I'm unfortunately Bill. I was out until when Bill started to teach in academy.
And seeing your works juxtaposed with the other artists, are you inspired or not inspired to go back and try something different or lift something?
I desperately try. It's funny, what's happening right now is very similar when I was on the fourth year of academy. And this was the time when I was madly in love with Nicholas de Staël. And it took me 10 years of searching with the... doing the poor canvases, poor thin acrylic paint on the canvas, and doing dirty paintings. It took 10 years, and then I come back to get back to my beloved Nicholas. Maybe I have too much of this influence. I'm trying to push it to the certain. I mean, what the artist do? He, if he get fortunate, he pick up his artist hero and try to push things just a little bit further to make your own personal contribution. Mm-hmm. Maybe not a big step, maybe even inch. Mm-hmm. And I don't think what I be able to introduce something what put me aside. It's still in the process, but I think right now a little bit too much underneath. I don't look at him, but I did saw his show in the Pompidou Museum 12 years ago. And it's still a big influence. And I would like to introduce some kind of modernize it, but I don't know, it's Kinder of Spirits or something. I don't know, but Nicholas de Staël and Liz Osborne, probably to my biggest influences. Mm-hmm. But just saying, if I can get, when you look at Liz's work, she always have her colors always have a good sound. There is always her work in a lot of ways, it's very musical. And there was a quote from Paul Gauguin in his Breton period, where he was working in Breton. He said, when I'm hearing of wooden sabot rocking on the ground of Breton, they produce the same powerful sound which I hear, which I'm searching the painting. This is quote in my translation from the Russian translation from the French, you know. But this is, again, this is this kind of talking about hearing the sound of the color. It's does have a big importance to me. Painting have to be a silent process as it is. It's have to produce the, in the end, your what's happening on the canvas have to produce the sound.
Then you look at Kandinsky. And
unfortunately, I don't like Kandinsky at all.
Not even the theory.
But this is where my Russian heritage kicked in, because believe you or not, even after 100 years, conventional view, Russian view on Kandinsky was his job. Believe you or not. I mean, we are talking about Russian as Russian Academy of Fine Art and. Mainly Russian art history. I know, well, somehow Kandinsky never had such an influence on me. Even as big as, because he was first who was starting to talk about musical connection to the sound. Somehow it escapes me. I was more, always more of a Chagall. I always was Chagall, like this kind of blue with red, you know, this kind of strange happening, strange people flying in the sky, and the greens and the blue. This was maybe I'm just was more of the guy who was waiting for color fields. Looking more, I'm more responding to the sound produced by the larger area of the color, not by certain strokes. I respond on Ashir Gorky, who have a lot of more similarity with the Kandinsky. I respond to him much more somehow. But it's my own perversion. Every artist pervert the art history in his own unique way.
Well, I mean, if the show is talking about color, you know, there's a scientific course of color, and there's the color you're speaking to. Expressive color, feeling, the sound, you know, even back to Goethe and Goethe's philosophy of color, it was not scientific based, it was more feeling based. And, you know, and you talk about Liz Osborne and people you look at, Nick Stichdale. When I came in today, I was looking at the pieces by Erin. I wish she was here because I wanted to ask her what her influences are. I can see some Klimt, I guess some Bernard, again, these subtle tonal shifts of color, but I'm not sure if she dyes her thread. But if you look at this paint in particular, there's blues and greens within this. And it's not readily, you have to stare at this for a little bit. And all these paintings, if you stare at them long enough, are going to give you something more. And that's what a painting should do, if you ask me. These are really beautiful. And again, all three of these groups of paintings, the color is just there, it's about color. And that's why your paintings, just, I love the tonal, I mean, they're just gorgeous paintings.
Thank you, you're trying to put, you're putting two inch by inch square paint of the right on your painting, and it's make more day and you want you like crazy. Oh, what do you do to the? I put the square paint on the right value in the right spot. So, I don't know, it's. Anyway. I like an Erin work, but there is certain kind of. When she's starting to apply, I like the play of the texture, which is kind of crossbreed painting back into the tapestry. This kind of unusual element of the showing the hand. And yet in the end it's going by pictorial laws. I like it.
Are the bottom pieces
and
that pieces that she put on or painted?
It's the fabric.
It's like a collage of the application of different fabrics. But she does do something with the fabric. She seems like she is, I don't know, maybe it was washed off with chlorine. Or she looks like she is taking it down and putting things up. And
yeah, but I mean, this one in particular, I really enjoyed. If you look at the color transition from this fabric to the thread.
Yeah.
And just tying this, you know, someone else's pattern, it's beautiful.
I think my only criticism. if she would put it in a plastic box, it would have a little bit more quality of the artifact.
Well, let me ask you this: if you were to go to frame that, how would you frame it?
I would frame it the way I frame mine. I would float it.
Okay.
I wish it was here because that's framing, not frame. That's every artist is different.
Would you stick with the white, or would you give it more color, or?
No, I would stick with the white. I would stick with
the white.
I don't know about you.
I would put keep totally transparency. Very shiny, transparent box. Just to keep almost like a display box. Just to keep, first of all, to protect it, and second, give it a little bit of the kind of. It would become to be a little bit more like an object.
Okay.
You know,
is this one of hers too?
Yeah.
Yes.
That's one of hers too.
Well, it's her artistic. It's really her artistic way, philosophy, how she has to develop it. It's the only thing to protect, because this do seems to be very fragile, so some kind of protection from the element have to be present. But how she will combine it with the because part of the way you exhibit, it's also a part of the your conceptual.
Why don't you frame your own work?
I used to do when I was work more of the when I did. I got a few years under a very interesting guy named Osvaldo Romberg. I don't know if people from Wakanda remember him. He was extremely conceptual. And I pick up on him with the idea of representing how much in the representation of work relating to your conception. And when I did, my experiment on far ago, what I started to burn holes in the paint and in the paper. And if you're going very conceptual, you have to also have to do framing. And how you present a piece of paint with a piece of paper with the burn holes. So there is have to be some kind of, you have to design your own frame for such a things.
Okay.
So yeah, I did frame for a while. One of the reasons why I stopped working on paper, because it's have to be framed. Mm-hmm. It's have to be protected. It's so delicate, so just like, I'm going to be more direct, I'm just going to work on canvas.
So Keith, yours is canvas, and his is canvas,
yeah.
And hers is paper too, right?
Paper and some
fabrics.
And combinations too, I think, so.
Are there certain papers that are better than others that you
use? It depends on what I do. Most of these are 140 cold press watercolor paper because it gives me a texture, so when I'm out the gate, I have some texture to deal with. If I really want to beat up the paper and scrub it, then I could put 300-pound Fabriano watercolor paper, which is very, very heavy indeed.
Okay. So like that one you did first, that's a canvas.
That's a canvas, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
The paper, it makes a difference. I hate cold press watercolor paper, I don't know why. It's very smooth.
Okay.
There is such a bounty of handmade paper right now.
Yeah,
you don't feel it tainted with something small with the decal edges, you know, very thick with kind of rough. No,
well,
no temptation.
Printmaking paper especially.
Yeah.
I would love to get hold of some really nice printmaking paper because of again the decal edge.
Yeah.
The texture there, what you can do with it, you can beat it up.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know, like I said, this keeps coming, so we'll see where it goes. I don't know how far.
So, Keith, you had described both other artists' work as beautiful, but I've never heard, I'll put it this way, to what extent is beauty part of your work?
Well, I think if you're going to use the word beauty and start tossing words around, you need to have a definition for it. That's a hard one. I was in school, we were, you didn't say beauty, but
right.
better than put this. In my right when I was in school, I defined beauty. I agree with Ralph Lauren, and his beauty was the harmony of nature. That harmony the ancient Greeks looked at. I like my works to look harmonious. I want them to be peaceful and calm and quiet. I like my color to be harmonious, so I work with families of colors and atlas colors. I work with complementary colors. So I want to be very solid. So that's my, why did I say this? I'm looking at, within this, there's analogous colors, you work with families of colors, you work with complementary colors, and that, for me, makes a painting. In the same way with the subtle colors, here's a family of colors, blues and greens, and then one of the list, and, that for me is a, and you can see that in painting, but in these paintings specifically, that is very apparent.
My follow-up was going to be, if someone was to compliment your work, what would make you think that, oh, this person has gotten what I'm trying to do?
A fresh paycheck. Actually,
someone came on opening night and slipped one of the paintings and said, "My mania." I said, "Thank you very much. You get it done. It's a wrap."
Hey, a lot of the paintings that I have at home that you've done from very early on, the ones you're going to throw in the trash can, ones I framed. They were mostly watercolors that were done on paper, correct?
Yeah, I was. I taught myself watercolor years ago, plein air watercolor. I would go out, and I did that for a very long time because I for like to the 90s, I would do that. I'd go
beautiful.
And I didn't do
paintings.
I never did a lot of work because I was afraid of making a mistake.
But in those paintings, you have. There's an object there.
Yeah, there's a representation.
Yeah.
Representation.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I guess I can.
Right.
Yeah. It's like
I see something there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Which I see something in these too, but it's a totally different.
But I have some beautiful here, the wisteria. See, that's my thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
she told me about my work. When I went back to school, I didn't study art in my undergrad. I went back for a master's. In fine art, and I went in thinking one way. I came out the other side completely different.
Completely.
Yeah, I was very reputational. People got sick of me bringing tree canes and this. and I had to let it go.
Do you feel like you're exploring the same things, just using a different sort of language?
Yeah, that's what I was saying.
Well, I talked to good game company in school about materials. Having a voice in my work, and at that time they really didn't. Now they do.
So you actually found what you were looking for.
That's important. So.
Yeah, well, I think it is.
You're also an avid gardener, and cooking is important too. So do you feel it's the same mentality? All those things?
I cooked for a very long time when I wasn't making a lot of art, because it's making, it's doing. You're doing this thing, and you're creating something. Like you create a garden, you create a dish. I had this urge to make stuff and do something. And I just put it off for a real time. So. Is that what you're going for?
Just wanted to hear what you had to say about that.
Yeah.
Since it's all sort of different facets of the same endeavor sometimes.
Yeah. I don't know.
I think it's the same. There is a lot of sensitivity in the cooking with the ingredients, and it's the same palate in the end, which...
Yes, I do.
I am somehow like terrified of the baking, but maybe this is my preference to the wet materials over the dry ones. But yes, I do cook, and it's a lot of... there is a lot of similarities.
Okay.
I mean, it's...
In gardening,
in the sense that, no, I don't.
Okay.
No, but gardening, I cannot talk about gardening. But in the cooking, there is also this kind of devils in the details. Just one of touch of something which could make a dish or ruin it. It's like the same thing in a painting. Mm-hmm. If you can take away a part of it, mm-hmm. and it's falling home, do the job.
Is your cooking full of bright, bold flavors?
Probably.
I studied architecture early in my life, and when I went back to school, a lot of the things that I studied in undergrad came to the fore. So when you asked me about beauty and things, one of the breakthrough moments I had, where these paintings come from particular, these works on paper and my oil paintings, since I graduated, at the end of the day, the painting is, all it is colors on a flat surface. And, you know, architecture, you have, material application program and those things. So that's what I started creating these things. The program of paint is that you're going to hang around the wall and look at it. You have the material, what it wants to be, and how you put it down. And that's where that's really the spine of my work. Mm-hmm. That's what holds it together. And this thing of Lou Kahn. Lou Kahn gave us a series of lectures at the University of Penn in the 70s, and one of his famous lines is, you have a brick, and you ask brick what it wants in making a building, so I like an arch. And Kahn would say, well, your brick's expensive, arch is expensive, but you ask a brick what it wants, and I like an arch. So it's what the material wants to be. And that's that's where this stuff comes from.
Do you like painting with the bigger canvas? Or?
I do when I can.
Okay.
Yeah, I have a very small studio, but I did some large paintings.
Well,
I'm not getting back. My house is full of paints. Every artist house is full of paints.
So the one when you walk in the door, it's like right there.
What do you like about size? Just the affection thing about it?
When you paint a large painting, not necessarily, but you get more impact. And when you come up to a painting, like an X-Martin painting, a bit right here, and you're engulfed. It's submersive.
Right. I think like Barnett Newman or something,
Takes
out your peripheral.
Yeah.
Or you can stand like this.
Yeah. Yes. Well, even on the postcard with the invitation, looking at yours in the center, believe it or not, for myself, I thought it was bigger. A bigger painting.
That's nice.
So when I saw it, I was surprised that it was the dimension of it.
I'll take a pose. I don't necessarily miss big paintings because I'm pretty happy with what this is happening right now.
Yeah, sure.
Again, there's when you paint large, there's this submersive thing that happens that I really enjoy.
Yeah, but I've seen how you've grown over the years too in your paintings too.
It's tricky. It happens, doesn't it? It's weird.
It's never a straight line.
It's never a straight line.
Sure.
And look at this room. There's three painters here who are they're similar, but they're also doing their own thing.
Uh-huh.
So.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes, very much so.
So Keith had mentioned he's done when the painting stops annoying him. Since, as you described it, you're starting with an
You feel it. It's just like, it's like looking at a pot, working in a pot of boiling water. You can feel it when you push it half of the way, and when you seal it, and basically it's coming through, it's kind of done, that's it. Then you hang it on the wall, and you just walk for 2 weeks around, and maybe you change something.
So you actually do go back?
Yes, I do go back, but it's a minor. I call it a tuning or finger touching. It's just basically. When it's done, it's done.
It looks like yours are trimmed as a final act.
There's not a lot of. These are, again, I take them down, And the edges, I trimmed them. I wasn't sure I was going to do that initially. Again, if I get hold of some of my nice paper, I might start tearing the edges. But I just, I wasn't quite sure what to do with them. So,
when you start making the painted area, I mean, how do you? You just sort of like
tape
feel for
went through the tape all over the whiteboard. That's where I cut it. I thought about leaving the board on some of these, the white border. I kind of enjoy it, but since I had the white frames, I thought that got a little redundant, so I trimmed them down.
Mm-hmm.